It's not just my, his or her house. This is our house.
Hello, my name is Tyrone Lowe. I'm your host. I'm the CEO of T-Lowe Video Productions. And in the house, I have Russell, Stewart, and Leroy, the legendary group Black Ivory. Welcome to my show, fellas.
Thank you. We appreciate that.
It's a real treat to have you guys here, and congratulations on your 50th anniversary as a group.
Okay.
Okay. Let's start off with Leroy. Let's talk about how you guys met.
Okay, long time ago, in the village of Harlem, I met a young gentleman named Larry Newkirk. We were actually working as youth counselors at St. Charles Borromeo's summer program for the kids.
Okay.
And one day on the basketball court, we were playing ball, radio playing transistor, little transistors from back in the day. Playing Here I Go Again by Smokey Robinson.
Okay.
And he starts singing, and I start singing. We start singing together, and we recognize each other's voice. He invites me into his group, a group called the Mellow Souls. So about a week after that,
About a week or two after that,
Larry ran into a brother who lives in his complex, Esplanade. All three of us are from Harlem, by the way. His complex is Esplanade Gardens, and Larry ran into this gentleman in the center, Stuart Bascom. He was the next to join the group. And along with Larry Newkirk, Michael Harris, and Vito Ramirez, the five of us comprised the Mellow Souls.
Okay.
Then we went to, Larry had, his sister knew a gentleman named Patrick Adams, who was a producer, fledgling producer, just getting his name up in the business, but he was more of a producer than any of us knew at the time. We went to meet him. First he listened to us over the phone because he couldn't make the rehearsal, and he liked the way we sounded, and then we went to meet him. At that point, the group evolved from a quintet to a quartet, and we began doing shows. Stuart, you take it from there.
Right. So probably about 6 months after we first met Patrick. Well, the first thing we did was we met Patrick at PS92 on Saturdays. We used to all gather around the piano. He would play the piano.
Mm-hmm. On 33rd Street in Harlem.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we would practice singing a lot of the popular songs that were out back then.
Mm-hmm.
One of our earliest inspirations were groups like The Moments, The Delphonics, The Unifics. So we were practicing songs like that.
Trying to develop an act.
Right. Now, Patrick lived in St. Nicholas Projects in Harlem. And he knew of a band that was from that area called the Soul Surveyors. So he got the Soul Surveyors together with us, and we started practicing, and we started probably in the springtime, started performing shows. First show we did was at a place called, it was a private party, I think at a place called the International House in Manhattan. But the very second show that we did was a talent show at Roosevelt High School, where we performed with the Soul Surveyors was the name of the band. And I think by that time we had changed our name to Black Ivory already.
Could be.
Yeah, no, we definitely, because we didn't do okay. That show as the Mellow Souls.
Okay.
That was one of the first things that happened, was that Patrick called me on the phone. He didn't think the name of the group, the Mellow Souls, was strong enough. So we sat there on the phone, going through the dictionary, putting adjectives with nouns and things like that.
Okay.
And suddenly he says the name Black Ivory. And I was like, man, that's it, man. That clicked right away. We took the name to the other fellows in the group, and
we loved it.
We loved it. So So that second show that we did at Roosevelt High School, the talent show, we came in first place and won. And that was our first experience with the girls going crazy and everything. And that was one of the things that that started us off. The following summer, we did a lot of block parties in Harlem, you know, and we started building a name.
At one point, if I may, mm-hmm. we were lucky enough that Patrick had a relationship with Mr. Gene Redd, who okay. happened to manage Kool & the Gang.
Was he also president of Delight Records at the time?
I don't know that he was president.
I knew he was actually affiliated with him.
He definitely was an A&R director at mm-hmm. one point
okay.
and had a very, very close relationship. Mm-hmm. At one time, Gene Redd was the only thing at Delight Records.
Right, exactly. Okay.
But he was starting his own label called Red Coach
Records. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. So Kool & the Gang was the band that he managed and so forth. And they put out their first hits, The Gang's Back Again, Chocolate Buttermilk, Kool & the Gang, so forth. But they came out as an instrumental band. Mm-hmm. And they didn't have any vocalists. So Patrick and Gene came up with this brainstorm. Why don't we use that as a forum to premiere Black Ivory? Okay. And so even before we had our first record, we had the opportunity of sharing some major stages with Kool & the Gang as they began to come up and so forth, with the blessing of them backing us mm-hmm. for a couple of songs. And that's how we got into the public's eye prior to the release of our first recording. Okay.
So, Russell, let's hear from you. How did you come into play?
I'm also from Harlem at the time. Okay. And there was a junior Mellow Souls group. There was a guy, Larry Newkirk, had a younger brother,
right. And
we called ourselves the Shades of the Mellow Souls.
Okay.
So when I got with the Shades, the first rehearsal once, they told me I could join the group. Mm-hmm. Leroy walks in, and they told me he was our manager. And I was like, okay.
News to me, but
and,
okay.
You know, we you know, cultivated a relationship, and then he introduced me to Stuart. And I think within 3 or 4 months, they asked me if I would become a member of Black Ivory, and I was like, yeah, I love it.
What happened?
I think I decided I wanted him in the group after seeing the first rehearsal.
Okay.
He was really great from the moment that we saw him. But also, Fraulein Ramirez, Vito Ramirez, who was in the group, and Larry Newkirk, decided to move on to college, to go to college and pursue their higher education,
right.
Leaving just Stuart and I. So at that point, we had heard him sing, and he was great.
Yeah,
and so we pretty much said, let's do that.
Mm. So what would you describe the impact of the first album, Don't Turn Around? How did Jay, you know, people really perceived it, you know, but how did y'all feel about it?
Who want to start that?
Well, I personally loved it. I mean, like I said, being the baby of the group and coming in, when I came in, they had done demos already and they were shopping, Patrick Adams was shopping the demos to record companies.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of lucked out because I think within 4 or 5 months after I joined the group, we had a record deal.
Okay.
And subsequently, we went to Philadelphia. We recorded Don't Turn Around down there. And that was the first single. And when the album came out, it was interesting because we were still in high school and Don't Turn Around came out when we came out the end of our 11th grade.
It was April.
April of when we were in 11th grade. So during the course of the summer, it became a hit. And when we went back to school in September, we were surprised doing that because we went to Brandeis High School. So we were sitting in class and over the loudspeaker, the principal announced that, you know, there were two students in the school who had a hit record out, and they played Don't Turn Around over the loudspeaker in the school, so we were both in class, you know. So it made an impact.
Wild, huh?
Yeah, it made an impact, the single. Okay. And when the album came out, you know, it was just icing on the cake, because at that time, once the single came out, we were doing, like, the Apollo, and we were doing shows with major acts as their opening. So it was, you know, we were still like 17, so for us it was wonderful.
So how would you describe the relationship with all three of y'all? Let's hear from you first, Russell.
Between me and them?
Yes. How would you describe the relationship?
How much time? I mean,
how would you describe the relationship
Well, we had the question.
Oh, okay.
Do you have beeps on the thing?
Can I? Yeah, no. Keep it clean. Keep it clean.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Okay.
They're nice.
Okay. Ah! Wow. Okay.
Okay.
No. I love these guys.
Okay.
You know, we've been together for a long time, and we all kind of know each other very well, to the point where, you know, there's things that we accept from each other and things that we love about each other. So it's like family.
Let's talk about this. Let me hear from you, Stu. What would you describe as far as your relationship with your peers?
Well, I mean, like you said, we've been together for a long time. We're celebrating our 50th anniversary, right. Same three original members of the group. So we spent a lot of time together, you know, back in the 70s when our records came out. And we were doing shows and we were on the road. We usually drove everywhere that we had.
Okay.
So we spent lots of time in cars together.
All the time.
Yeah. We flew occasionally.
Yeah.
But right. Most of the time we were in cars with our manager at the time, who was Lenny Adams, driving all of them down the East Coast, Midwest.
Yeah.
A lot of time going through Pennsylvania, through Ohio, Chicago, you know,
down 95.
So there was plenty opportunity for us to get on each other's nerves, but then also plenty opportunity for us to bond,
mm-hmm.
you know. And just like any group, you know, we've had our ups and downs.
Right.
And even for a period of time, we separated, you know, but we got back together in 1995.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there was an opportunity at that time because the New York radio stations had begun to play classic soul. Again, so now there was an opportunity for us to work
mm-hmm.
and do live performances.
There was a demand, kind of, sort of, for us mm-hmm. by some people.
Right. So there was an impetus mm-hmm. of our, or the catalyst for us getting back together was our manager, Lenny Adams, had passed away.
Right.
And at his funeral, came up with the idea, well, how about us getting back together? So we all met. We ironed out whatever differences we may have had during the course of the separation, and we started working together again. And one of the things that we decided at that time was that whatever decisions were made, whatever moves we made career-wise, we would all have to be in agreement. So, you know, we pretty much never went back to having a manager, somebody over us telling us when we're going to do something, mm-hmm. so forth and so on. We basically manage the careers together. And so it's sort of by committee, whereas, you know, we try to have everybody's agreement
mm-hmm.
Before we do something. But also, if any one of us is adamant about not doing something, we won't do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we work together on it.
My turn?
Yes, sir.
I was waiting.
I think Leroy's getting ready to do a remix.
Okay. The best way, if this is me, this is what my spin is. Black Ivy is a formula, started out as a formula with Patrick Adams, myself, Stuart, and Russell, and eventually what we created together. It's unique. And it's an energy that's very specific to itself. It's that energy that has held us together and holds us together, all right? Through, as Stuart said, ups and downs, ins and outs, good and bad, there and not. That energy holds us together. And upon my reuniting with the group in 95, it's that we've been building up until this point when you put all the years together, it's a total of 50 years. But what holds us together is that formula of inclusion, you know, where we share ideas, we talk to each other, we try to work everything out.
Right.
And all three of us are very creative people. We're all lead singers. And we're at our best when we're flowing in that way, working. But Black Ivy is a formula, and that is a powerful force. And more than anything, that's what holds us together, that force, the force of what Black Ivy is.
And the other thing is that we've also maintained over the years the same type of youthful exuberance in dealing with one another and with other people. I mean, you know, the right. joking around and interaction you see here when we're sitting here with you is the same thing that we used to have. Riding on the number 3 train out to Brooklyn, sitting on the train, joking, laughing, messing with people, you know.
And it keeps us fresh. It keeps the music fresh.
Right.
Keeps us happy. Keeps our audiences happy because we enjoy each other. Right. We are, you know, brothers in the truest sense of the word, in that we're friends and we're close and we share something as important as music. And we're able, blessed to be able to have an audience that actually accepts and receives and appreciates that.
Right.
So that's one of the cool things about it. But, you know, like I said, through our ups and downs, we're regular people, just like anybody else. But, you know, we're also musicians.
You're regular.
You know, it's very funny because...
I am regular right now. I took my Metamucil.
Okay, good.
My other stuff.
Because I couldn't tell. Oops.
Yeah, you know. Y'all be smelling it by now.
Okay.
You know, it's very funny because due the strategies of from the beginning, from Don't Turn Around to a certain point, y'all just broke out with Mainline.
And that just explained. A whole lot happened.
Well, yeah, there was a whole lot.
Okay.
Yeah. That was the beginning
I'm
and the end.
I'm just saying, because me being a DJ, when I first got the record, you know, I got it as a promotional copy, and I played it, it packed the floor. You know, so I'm just saying, it just exploded.
Yeah. Well, there was quite an evolution.
Okay.
In terms of our own musical ideas,
okay.
leading from how we started up into Mainline. I mean,
okay.
you know, for the most part, the Don't Turn Around album was really the brainchild of Patrick Adams.
Okay.
You know, we did some writing on it, and there were some of our ideas, particularly If I Could Be a Mirror, that Leroy penned and arranged and basically did
You and I, which you
like
and
that.
I wrote.
Right, okay.
Right.
Yeah.
But that, you know, those songs were basically in the mold of the Philly sound to a large extent.
Right.
And that's what we became popular for.
Mm-hmm.
But musically, all of our heads were always in
different
lots
places.
Of different places.
Yeah.
You know,
okay. We've all like different
we
types
did
of
up-tempo
music.
Stuff like Daily News and dance and so forth. But the one that was, that caught everybody was Mainline. And I don't know, there was just a formula with that.
Yeah.
Where I returned to the group for that moment in order for us to do that song together. And there was just an energy to it. There's something that Russell did this amazing lead vocal. We had a great band. Earl Young was on drums from MSSB. Patrick Adams. Patrick Adams did the arrangement.
And by the way, MSSB is one of my favorite bands, man.
So a lot of the elements just came together. Of all of the up-tempo stuff that we've done, Mainline was the one that caught the dance audience.
Right.
And to be perfectly honest, the audiences that were used to us doing slow jams, right, when Mainline came out, it was like, oh, that's Black Ivory?
Right.
Wow, you know, that sounds like a whole... So it opened up a whole new audience for us. And a whole new style of doing things because now we were no longer typecast as a slow, blue, magic-y, delphonic-y type of thing. We had something we always had been looking to achieve, variety and versatility, which is something we always had.
Yeah, because our record companies always wanted to keep us pigeonholed into that slow ballad love song thing.
Yeah.
And we always wanted to do different types of music.
But that mold had already really been broken.
And it
when,
was, yeah.
When,
okay.
What goes around comes around.
Right.
Which after we left Perception Today Records, we went with a label called Kwanzaa, and we went to Philly, and we were produced by some people down there, and
Victor Drayton.
Okay,
don't.
It was supposed to be Norman Harris.
Yes.
Right.
But
right.
You know, they turned us over to the Sega, the B team. And but they ended up coming up with a pretty decent record.
Yeah, because you said that MFSB is one of your favorite bands.
Yes.
Philadelphia Sound, were on What Goes Around Comes Around.
Because
that
MSSB
else.
Philadelphia Sound is just a unique type of sound.
Right? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, nobody could really duplicate that in no type of form or fashion. That's my honest opinion.
Mm-hmm. So we recorded two songs with them. What Goes Around Comes Around and No One Else Will Do. Vince Montana did the arrangement for
Vince,
What Goes Around Comes Around.
Right.
And Norman Harris actually did the arrangement for No One Else Will Do.
Okay.
And our only appearance on the television show Soul Train, we performed What Goes Around Comes Around. Now, that was an up-tempo
right.
cut. You know, so we sort of started going in that direction already.
Mm-hmm.
And then by the third album, Feel It, when we actually had an opportunity to start doing our own
and producing it ourselves, yeah.
You know, okay. you started getting songs like Your Eyes Say Goodbye, Dead Warm News. Inside, Dead
White Winds.
Right.
And then on the fourth album, White Wind, Dance.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So we did, we broke into dance music and up-tempo music because, as I said, we've always had a lot of variety. Our shows, we always did up-tempo songs,
right.
stuff like that. And we used to do cover versions of songs like Happy People by The Temptations.
Fire by The Hard Place.
Right, and a song for you, From Us to You by The Stair Steps.
Okay.
So we always had that dance stuff in us, but again, Russell used the perfect word of pigeonholing. And I augment that with stereotyping. How our audience just wants you to be, you know,
it wasn't
this
so much the audience
thing.
Too. It was the administration. A lot of when we came into the music business, a lot of people behind the scenes were musicians,
right.
and into music, and then it transitioned into suits, where a lot of people were just looking for profit,
right.
So they wanted to keep us in a way that they knew we would make money for them, and we wanted to be like Stevie Wonder and people who
right.
who had like you listen to their albums. There's all kinds of different music on their albums, and that's what we wanted to do.
Yeah.
Briefly, Leroy, let's talk about you. You know, let's talk about Conversion and Log.
Okay.
How did you come about that?
In '77, I went on a journey of self-discovery
mm-hmm.
that involved my stepping away from my group at the time. Because it's something that I felt I could not really engage in inside of or while I was a part of the group. So I had to actually step away. 77 was the opportunity, and it began with me writing songs. Going back to Patrick Adams, and he put me on, started as a keyboard player, then as a background vocalist. Then he began to listen to the songs. Ultimately, this led to songs like Weekend and... ultimately, Conversions, Let's Do It. And that then Conversion became Log, and that became I Know You Will. Along that time, we went with, I was also working with the Aleem Twins, the Fantastic Aleems. We did records like Hooked on Your Love, Love's on Fire, and so forth. I also wrote songs for Rick James. Had a great song with him called Big Time. All of this was just Leroy, but let me find out who I am, right? Fonda Ray over Like a Fat Rat is another one. So all of which karmically
mm-hmm.
led me back to my group, right? To bring all of those energies, you know, everything that I had learned back to my home base. And so that's where those things came from, my journey of self-discovery.
Okay. Well, our time is almost up, fellas, and I'm glad that we really had this conversation. I'm glad that my viewers
we
got a little touch
the
of... Well, you know, it just happens to be that way. You know,
this is a 50-year thing, so you need a lot of
well,
time.
Well, we'll do another 50 years.
We got to do a part two. And
well,
part
we could probably
three.
Do that.
Let's make a series of it. And,
okay, we probably do that, you know, too. We'll do a few episodes.
Sell it to
Babylon.
Sell it to NBC.
Well, I thank you guys for stopping by the House of the Legends. I really appreciate you guys coming through.
Okay.
And by the way, they're going to do a live performance for you guys, and I hope you guys enjoy it. And, you know, come back again.
Okay.
Thank you for having us, Tavon.
You know, I love you guys. I got a story behind you guys, man. I was in love with a girl when I was 15.
Okay.
And she was only 12.
Okay.
And it just didn't work out. But when I heard Spinning Around, it really spun me around. You know,
wow.
It was really an intensive song.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think, to be honest with you, the most intensive song that I really heard from you guys, because it had a lot of meaning,
well,
a lot of soul to it.
It's a part
not
of your
knocking
life.
You,
it's a part of
but it's
your
a part
life.
Of my story.
Right.
And I thank you guys.
Well,
so,
thank you.
Like I said, my name is Tyrone Lowe. I'm the CEO of T-Lo Video Productions. And I want to thank Black Ivy for coming to the house today. And we have more episodes coming up sooner or later. So stay tuned. Thank you very much.
Tyrone Low.